I welcome all of you, once again, members and friends of Fulbright, to the world of Coca-Cola. I express our very deep gratitude to the Coca-Cola Company, and welcome Dennis Ryan, Vice President of Coca-Cola, and a fellow Fulbrighter, Fenton May, for making this wonderful evening and reception possible. While we are extremely appreciative of all of our sponsors, such as Coca-Cola, we do rely on your donations, and we hope that you'll consider supporting us as we now enter into a new Funded Forward Fulbright campaign. Tonight, you'll have the opportunity to go through this unique museum, but first, we have two exciting events. First, the presentation of the Fulbright Lifetime Achievement Award to Maurizio Gianturco, a lifelong Fulbright supporter who personifies Senator Fulbright's ideal of bringing together people from all over the world. And second, a lecture and performance by Dr. Madeleine Hackney, our 2015 Selma Jean Cohen Lecture Fellowship. Fenton, would you please come to the podium? Fenton came to the U.S. on a Fulbright scholarship just a couple of years ago to get his PhD in chemical engineering at the University of Wisconsin. He's a former director of operations at the Coca-Cola Company and president of Far Eastern subsidiaries of Coca-Cola. He's a former director and president of the Fulbright Association and a good friend indeed.
Thank you, John, for that gracious introduction. Fellow Fulbrighters, Mrs. Dina Gianturco, if I can just introduce her briefly. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. I've had the privilege of knowing Maurizio since I moved to Atlanta in 1972, where, as John said, after I finished my PhD at the University of Wisconsin, when I also worked in R&D programs of the Coca-Cola Company. Maurizio, throughout the time that I knew him, took great pride in his activities at the Fulbright Association. In fact, he got me to join as a life member and more or less press-ganged me when I came back from China. He also encouraged me to go on the board of the Fulbright Association. Maurizio was part of a group of business-oriented directors, including the late John Herford, who were brought to the board by Dick Arndt, and we have the pleasure of sitting in the front row, if you could take us down in a bow, sir. And put in place the first real development and fundraising activities of the Fulbright Association, and John said how we're going forward with that now. Maurizio served as board president of our association and was president in 1994 and 1995. As a Fulbright scholar and associate of the Coca-Cola Company for many years, Maurizio was also responsible for fostering the early relationship between the Coca-Cola Company and the Fulbright Association. He recognized that in order to raise the profile of the Fulbright program, we needed some high-profile activities, and that he helped lead the effort of the board and the association to develop the Fulbright Prize, and obtained support from his boss at the time, the late Roberto Goizueta, for Coca-Cola Foundation to underwrite the first 13 years of the Fulbright Prize program. And that was a donation of about $1.5 million from the Coca-Cola Company for that activity. The J. William Fulbright Prize, for those of you who may not know, the Prize for International Understanding, honors the largest and most significant educational and cultural program in history, as well as the career and spirit of its creator, the late Senator Fulbright. It has helped to enhance the recognition of the Fulbright program considerably, and the Fulbright Prize itself recognizes and rewards outstanding contributions for bringing together peoples, cultures, or nations to greater understanding of each other. And as John commented earlier, it's unfortunate that certain people in Paris don't have that understanding. But between us, I think we all do, and we know how to foster it with others. It's, as a result, laureates have included Atlanta's own former President Carter, former President Clinton, first free president of South Africa, Nelson Mandela, and the former presidents of Austria, Brazil, Chile, Czech Republic, Finland, and Ireland, among others. And so you can imagine how that has brought up the profile of the Fulbright Association and the Fulbright Scholarship Program in all of those environments. Maurizio saw the importance of how reaching across boundaries and bridging diverse cultures and educational experiences could benefit both educational and business sectors. He successfully walked the talk in the Coca-Cola Company in managing its global development activities. This Fulbright Lifetime Achievement Award honors the many efforts and contributions that our good friend Maurizio Gianturco made to the Fulbright Association. Let me say a little more about Maurizio. He was born in Italy and grew up there during another troubled period in our history, World War II. He came from a family of achievers. His father and uncle were doctors, and in fact, his father ran a hospital. And the Fulbright program gave him the opportunity, gave Maurizio the opportunity, to come and study in the United States, where he could cultivate his early and successful career. The experience that Fulbright afforded him, or the Fulbright scholarship afforded him, made it possible for him to live out his dream. He received a PhD in organic chemistry from the University of Rome, Italy, in 1953, and from 1954 to 56, as a Fulbright senior scholar at the University of Illinois, he continued his work on the chemistry and of aromatics in coffee and tea flavor. He joined the Tenko Company, at the time an independent company making early instant tea and coffee, to continue his work on coffee and tea flavor. Tenko was purchased by Coca-Cola in 1965, after which Maurizio and his family moved to Atlanta. He then became director of the new corporate R&D department, from which position he eventually rose to senior vice president of science. Maurizio's sons, Luca, who's here, if he could stand and take a bow, with his hair with his family, and Giulio, who regrets that he could not be here, have mentioned how their parents always stressed the importance of education and focus on providing educational opportunities to the next generation. And I think all of us know that really the only thing you can give your kids is a good education. They might want this and that, but the good education is better than anything. And it was this spirit that drove Maurizio's support of the Fulbright ideal and the support given to it by the Coca-Cola Company. In closing with that introduction of Maurizio, let me now introduce Dennis Ryan. Come on up, Dennis, a vice president of the Coca-Cola Company and a protege of Maurizio, to add his thoughts and to welcome you on behalf of the Coca-Cola Company. Dennis.
Thank you, Fenton, and it's a pleasure to welcome you to the world of Coca-Cola on behalf of all the Coca-Cola Company. We're honored to host you tonight, and we're proud to be a part of your annual conference. At Coca-Cola, as Fenton said, we have a proud history of association with the Fulbright. We've supported the organization for many years, as well as the prize. And we've counted a number of Fulbrighters among our employees, and several of them among leaders of our corporation, including Dr. Tony Amon and Dr. Fenton May, both of whom have served on the board of this organization. Tonight is a very special night for us as we continue the proud history of that association in the honoring of Dr. Maurizio Gianturco, the retired executive of the Coca-Cola Company and former president of the association. As Fenn said, Dr. Gianturco served on the board of this association from the late 80s to 1995 and was president in 1994 and 95. I personally had the privilege to work with Dr. Gianturco towards the end of his career, and I knew him as nothing more than a scholar and a gentleman. No matter what the situation, Maurizio always was the calm voice in the room. So it was an honor and a privilege to be able to work with such a distinguished leader. His leadership style is collegial and inclusive, and his work and his association with our R&D teams around the world enabled us to help form the global R&D organization that supports the company today. So it's really a privilege for me to be here with you tonight. Thank you, Dr. Fenton May, for the invitation and the opportunity to just say a few words about Dr. Gianturco. I know this As I look around this room and I hear more about your organization, I know that this room is filled with leaders, people with big ideas, and people who have the ability to take those ideals and change the world. So thank you for your expertise, your leadership, and your commitment to changing the world, especially in light of what we just heard tonight. So enjoy your time at the World of Coca-Cola. Enjoy your time in Atlanta. Cheers.
Thank you, Dennis. Maurizio is not able to be with us this evening, and the award is being received by his lovely wife, Dina, and the presence of his younger son, Luca, and his family, and Dina's family. The board of the Fulbright Association became much more professional with the addition of Maurizio, his insights, and we are incredibly grateful for his support with the help of the Coca-Cola Foundation, as Dennis said, and the Coca-Cola Company for the first 13 years of our Prize of International Understanding. Maurizio's life and leadership exemplify and reflect the ideals of the late Senator Fulbright. Dina, it is my great pleasure indeed to give you this Lifetime Achievement Award from the Fulbright Association to Maurizio Gianturco for his lifetime service to the foundation, to the association. Rachel, granddaughter, would you like to come up and say a few words? Thank you.
Thank you, Fulbright Association, for recognizing the achievements of my grandfather, Dr. Maurizio Gianturco. My name is Rachel Schwartzman, and I'm the granddaughter of Dr. Maurizio and Dina Gianturco. My grandfather is an incredible human being who has thrust his knowledge, his life lessons, and values upon me. Maurizio is very proud to receive this award, and I am honored to be able to give this short response on behalf of Maurizio and Dina. Maurizio has always stressed to us the importance of education, hard work, entrepreneurship, and philanthropy. Education is so valuable because there is no limit to what a person can learn, but you have to pursue and stick with it and use education to its full potential. It comes with hard work. There are supposed to be challenges. Without challenges, commitment, and hard work, life would be easy. But it would be boring, and there would be no experiments, no innovations, no entrepreneurs, and no new opportunities that would come about for the growth of humankind. Maurizio has taught our family to take on challenges, to take on responsibilities, and to go on for what we wish. In doing so, he taught us to be innovators, leaders, teachers, communicators, and resources to others. This brings me to my next point. Maurizio helped teach what it means to be a good human being through philanthropy and kindness. The importance of being kind and open to all is so profound because it opens our eyes to communities that come together that make the people in this world so great. Giving back to this world, to its students, to its people is most important. We have so much, and even if we do not, it is important to give back because others have less. The point my grandfather said is to give a person an opportunity to learn, grow, and succeed, just as he was able to by the Fulbright Association helping him come to the U.S. to study. Through his own experience, he created a scholarship where students could come to the States to receive an education because he values all people and believes each student should have a chance here. In doing so, he helps others gain the American dream by inspiring others to do more than their socioeconomic differences. He inspires us all to do more and to be great. These life lessons have forever shaped his children and grandchildren's lives that we are forever thankful for. And just as my grandfather has impacted my family and others, others have impacted him, in particular, Dr. Fenton May. Thank you, Dr. Fenton May, for being a good friend and supporter to this family. And thank you again, Fulbright Association, for my grandfather's recognition. He is very proud to receive this. Enjoy your evening.
Thank you very much, Rachel. And now we move on to the next phase of our evening. And I would like Mary Ellen Schmitter to come forward and tell us a little bit about the Selma Jean Cohen Award.
Years ago, when the Fulbright Association began, the look for things that were unique, that we would raise up scholarship across the entire world of knowledge, was one of the things that moved us. And one of the wonderful things that happened is that one of the great founders of dance scholarship, Selma Jean Cohen, at the end of her life, agreed to leave her money in an endowment fund so that every national conference could have the Selma Jean Cohen Dance Award. I don't know of any other association that has an endowed dance scholarship as part of its association, which is quite wonderful. And what's even more interesting, of course, is that when we ask for the proposals from dance scholars, we say, you know, the audience you're going to have is not an audience of dance scholars. It's an audience of doctors and lawyers and teachers and professors and people in all areas of life. And so what you know as a scholar, what you've done on the leading edges of dance scholarship, needs to get translated so that it makes sense for an intelligent but not specialized audience. In 2012, that award went to someone I'm going to introduce in a moment who was leading edge technology. And she said, with technology and the interaction and the mashup of time and space that you can do now technologically, just add movement. A rare and wonderful effect of what dance can mean. And that woman is Josephine Dorado, who had her Fulbright, I don't know the year, was it 2011 or 2010? Oh, is that long ago? She's been dancing and moving technology forever. She's president of the New York chapter of the Fulbright Association. She's been engaged with us deeply for several years. And in fact, she gave the lecture on Just Add Dance in London in 2012 and chaired this year's Selma Jean Cohen Dance Award Scholarship Committee. So I'm really glad to welcome her tonight.
Thank you, Mary Ellen, for such a lovely introduction. I am very honored to introduce Dr. Madeleine Hackney to you all tonight, who is a dancer, a research scientist, and an assistant professor of medicine. And what struck me as the committee, read all the Selma Jean Cohen proposals is not only how apropos Dr. Hackney's themes and research is to this particular theme of the conference, but also how necessary it is for research like this to be done in an ever-rising population of elderly in the world. As you'll see from her presentation, her work adapting the mechanics of tango to improve balance, mobility, and the quality of life in older adults is fascinating and well worthy of the Selma Jean Cohen Award. So, congratulations.
Thank you. Many thanks to Manuel Patino, my professional tango partner. Thank you so much. All right. So it's my great, great honor to be here for this award and this lecture. I'm absolutely stunned by it all, and I'm just really thrilled that I get to talk to you about what dance can do for medicine and for people who have degenerative disease that prohibits them to move as well as they have in the past, and for older adults and many other conditions. And so I'm just so excited to tell you about this story. So here we go. So by the way, we first started off, I was dancing a milonga. That's actually a form of dance and music that predates the tango, which came a little bit later in the development. And that's the second piece that Manuel and I danced juntos or together was a waltz, a tango waltz. And then the final piece was a tango. All right, so now you know that there's, if you go to tango dance, there are three different types that you'll have to learn: milonga, tango, and waltz. All righty, so I hope you enjoyed that portion of the program. Now I'm gonna put on my scientist hat, all right, and talk to you about the research. This is about why partner dance can optimize motor rehabilitation, movement rehabilitation for people with Parkinson's disease, with a particularly neuroscientific perspective, but it's very accessible to all. Let me see if I can find that clicker. Here we go. Okay, so today, I am a scientist and a geriatric neurokinesiologist. That's the best title I could come up with for myself. I know I'm a kinesiologist for sure because my PhD is in movement science from the Washington University in St. Louis. But there's these other aspects that are very important. I work with the geriatric population a lot. I also work with very young people in their 50s and above. So I don't call that geriatric at all, trust me, because I'm just around the corner from that myself. So I think that we need to see lifespan as like going on way beyond. And the whole point is always, what can we do to maintain quality of life and independence throughout a lifetime, whether you're going to be 95, 96, whatever. That's our goal over at Emory in the Center for Health and Aging. So, thank you. I'm glad I supported in that. Yes, you look fantastic. Okay, so I used to be a dancer and a dance teacher. I had a 14-year career as just a dancer. That was what I was. I have my bachelor's degree in fine arts from the New York University Tisch School of the Arts. And I started off more as a ballet dancer, a modern dancer. Of course, a modern dancer, because you get your degree basically in modern dance. And then over the years, I discovered that I actually liked partner dancing. And I'll tell you a little bit about that. And so that's why I have these are some pictures of when I used to be a performer. And I think that this experience and the ability that I have to teach dancing and the fact that I understand it and that I had a lot of injuries myself and had to learn how to overcome those problems have laid a real foundation for my research that I do now, which I consider that crosses nations' boundaries. So, ironically, when I returned to the States in about the year 2000, I decided to go, I was touring Europe and Japan and other places for several years. Finally, I returned to New York and I wanted to put down roots of sorts in New York. And what I found was an international language, human-to-human connection that is conveyed through the beautiful art form of Argentine tango dancing. And this is a picture of a very authentic frame right there. Let's see. Is there a laser pointer? No, I don't. Not really. But that couple right there. It looks perfect. That's in Rosario, Argentina, and that was at the first tango therapy conference. Yes, there are those. Maybe they need an endowed lecture as well. First tango therapy conference. That was in 2008. And so tango is a wonderful dance form that blends steps that challenge mobility and balance. Perhaps Manuel and I were able to show that, I hope, a little bit. It has rhythmic music that has European, Caribbean, and African influences. And it also has this history. I don't know if anybody knows about the history of tango, but it's very interesting in and of itself, fraught with political and moral and social events. And interestingly, tango also might help people with Parkinson's disease move better. So Parkinson's disease is a progressive neurodegenerative disease that's affecting roughly 1 million Americans. And most of them are older than 60 years of age. And so because we have the silver tsunami, anybody heard that one? The idea that we're having more and more older individuals. The cases of Parkinson's disease are definitely going to be doubling by the year 2030. And so we need to be really prepared for that. So Parkinson's disease symptoms include, there's the four cardinal signs, which are something called bradykinesia, which is basically slow movement, tremor, rigidity, and postural instability or balance problems. And Parkinson's disease primarily affects an area of the brain called the basal ganglia, which does things for us like determining size and timing of a movement. So it has to do a lot with our internal generation of movement, the ability to do things automatically. Okay, so sometimes for some people with PD, that ability to just do things, to just get up and go, that ability is sometimes depleted. And actually the Parkinson's symptoms result mostly from the fact that you're producing less dopamine, which is a very important chemical in your brain. So your brain does a lot of squirting of chemicals, and dopamine is one of them. And if that starts to deplete, that's a problem. So PD has cognitive and motor challenges that definitely need therapies. Falls are a huge problem for people with Parkinson's and also older adults in general. Statistics are that 1/3 of adults over the age of 65 are going to fall in the next year, and that leads to morbidity and mortality and other things. And Parkinson's is especially dear because in one study, one epidemiological study, 70% of people with the Parkinson's in the study fell in a year, and then the next year, half of them fell again. So it's a very, very common problem, and we need therapies. So fortunately, exercise programs can improve balance. So that's something that we can look to. It really can. There is evidence, strong evidence, that shows that physical therapy involving mobility and balance can help with this fall, these falls issues. Now, you have to have two things in an exercise program to help your balance. And one of them is you have to practice maintaining balance while walking, meaning you lose balance and regain it with every step. And that's what we do all the time when we walk. Think about that later on when you're enjoying the Coke tour. Think about what's happening. You're losing and you're regaining your balance every single time, and you do it automatically. So things like the basal ganglia are helping you with that, all right? So just think about what's going on there. Another thing that you need in an exercise program designed to improve your mobility and balance is you have to have new and unexpected balance challenges. I'm just gonna give an idea of what happens in your environment at home. Maybe you have a pet that gets under your feet and you have to kind of catch your balance. Or maybe there's that grape in the supermarket that you really shouldn't step on. These are the sorts of things. So you have to have in the program those sorts of things set up for you, all right? So your brain and your body and your muscles can learn how to deal with those unexpected challenges. That's how you'll improve your balance. So do we know that this is pretty true? Participation in exercise is unfortunately a little bit low in the United States. Seniors, 60% of our seniors are not getting enough. They're not getting the recommended daily amount, which is 150 minutes per week of moderate exercise, according to the American College of Sports Medicine. Think about that too. Are you getting your 10,000 steps? And unfortunately, Parkinson's disease activity levels are even lower than that. However, group social dance can motivate some older adults to be more active. So we should take advantage of therapies that people actually enjoy and will want to do. So, dance. Dance is the art of movement. It's fantastic, and there's so many different forms of dance. And I want to kind of, talk about a little bit about them. So they percolate in your idea, in your mind, and then you're like, you'll maybe see where I'm going with what dance we have actually decided to study. But there's beautiful dances, and they all should be studied, as a matter of fact. They probably all have benefits in different ways. So we have Balinese dancing and contemporary dancing and hip hop and Ponche arabesque, anyone? And West African dancing. Oh my God, the rhythms in West African dancing are amazing. And then international standard waltzing, Bharatanatyam, Indian dancing, all fantastic. And this down here, I don't know, does anybody know what kind of dancing this is? Does anybody watch So You Think You Can Dance? It's something called crunk. Yes, I had never heard of crunk. And when I was coming up, it was just hip-hop or jazz. Hip-hop or jazz. But now they're doing so many different dances. My goodness. So I don't know if I'll be doing a crunk study anytime soon, but it's definitely, you know, something to think about. And so maybe social dance, though, could be a wonderful therapy for brain and body health. And there's some early evidence. I want to talk a little bit about the early evidence that we had that allowed me to begin studies. I began studies in about 2006 when I was a doctoral student at the Washington University School of Medicine. And when I was first thinking about, you know, I was a dancer, so I wanted to keep on studying dance. I had to find, and when you do science, you have to find, like, previous literature to back up your ideas. At least a kernel. You need something. And so I did a little bit of a literature review. And I found that there was one study, you know, dance movement therapy, which is a beautiful form of therapy. They had actually done a PD study in 1989, and they had shown that it improved PD movement initiation, the ability to get up and go, right? That internal generation idea. So that was cool. And also, there was a in Italy, they had shown that waltz improved quality of life as well as cardiovascular function in heart failure patients. Great. And then in 2005, they put their, this was at McGill. McGill put out an abstract that tango, an Argentine tango program, had improved frail older adults walking more than did a traditional walking program. So that was exciting. At that point, we could start to think about it. My advisor was starting to say, maybe you should think about teaching tango to people with Parkinson's, because that's where the predominant population that she was studying. So, but why? Why should we study dance's effect on brain activity? Well, people are living longer. We already know about that. And the brain's integrity impacts everything, independence and quality of life, very directly. And we need therapies that actually can take advantage of something called neural plasticity, which I'll define in a moment. But it's a very, very exciting concept. And it's needed for, these therapies are needed to improve motor and cognitive function. So there are a lot of possibilities that we know about today with neuroplasticity, which is the brain's ability to modulate its connections as a result of experiences. Now, hopefully, those experiences can be new activities that are positive. Okay, so it's the brain's ability to function better with positive new experiences. Now, you have to challenge your brain with new activities. So you can have new connections forming between brain cells, and the communication between those brain cells can be better. And the benefits can often increase when the challenges are ongoing and from a recurring or habitual arts activity. So why not dancing, for example? Make use of creativity that's inherent to dance. So because of that, I had to think, let's take advantage of neuroplasticity, which we now know is a real thing. And let's see, we got this tango evidence that it helped frail older adults. So why not? Why not try to adapt Argentine tango for the specific impairments of individuals with Parkinson's disease? And I'm going to talk a little bit about why tango would be so good for each of these issues that some people with PD experience. So there's the slow movement, the bradykinesia, which means from the Greek, poverty of movement. When you're doing tango, did you see that how Manuel and I were doing both fast and very slow movements? So you get to do that. You get to practice that. Now, here's a caveat. My individuals with Parkinson's always dance with a healthy individual, who is stable, often a younger undergraduate student, perhaps, somebody who's interested in pre-health or otherwise. So they get to practice steps in the guise of this safety. With a safety net, a safety partner. Okay, so they can practice their balance issues because you have to lose and regain with every single step. There's a lot of this, very precise, and you really want to stay on your axis as you do so. Turning and multitasking. You get to turn with all manner of steps, and you get to really work on the twisting through the waist so that you get that it's called axial rigidity. So sometimes people end up very stiff, and you need to get that back. And you get to practice that a lot in ballroom dancing and in tango. Multitasking. When you're dancing tango, you have to think about the partner you're dancing with, the music, the next step. It's a great example of multitasking. Backward walking. As we get older, it's something called limits of stability, the ability to keep your balance without falling. They tend to get smaller and smaller and smaller, especially in the backward direction. So backward walking is actually super important to practice safely. Now, when you're dancing tango, you learn how to do that, how to really bring your foot back and then bring your torso and chest over the foot such that you do not lose your balance. So it's a perfect example of how you can practice a task that you actually need. Because who knows when you're going to be standing on the curb and a swiftly moving bus comes by and you have to step back. It's a skill that we actually would like to retain throughout our lifetime. And then, of course, getting up and going without help. In tango, you learn all sorts of steps, and you have to be ready and prepared, and you have a lot of time to practice shifting of weight, etc. It's just a beautiful dance form, and it's a nice way to actually practice these things, these skills that are typically found within the physical therapy setting, but perhaps because of that social aspect, will be more attractive and lend to better compliance with the therapies. So adapt to tango classes. I've done several studies since 2006. However, several of them always involved, they involved this 20 lessons, either 1 hour or 1.5 hours. They came twice a week, and they tried to finish the 20 lessons within 10 to 13 weeks. Everyone was leading and following steps. So they had to learn the leading role, whether or not they're a man or a woman, and then immediately they learned the following role. Again, whether or not they're a man or woman. So what we try to do is that we control, in a study, you have to kind of control and make sure everyone's doing the same thing. So they learn all the same steps. And I hope that it also created a little empathy, because sometimes when people are in a dance class and one's leader and one's follower, there's a little bickering that goes on between couples. But if you have to learn the other role right away, you can certainly maybe develop a little bit more empathy. Progressive, everyone learns something every single week, even if they don't want to. And sometimes that's something that people don't want to push past. They would like, because it feels uncomfortable. But if it feels uncomfortable, what does that probably mean? Anybody? Learning, exactly. And that's based on the principle of the plasticity. Exactly, exactly. So it's not a bad thing to feel uncomfortable. It's actually good. And again, I said that we have PD folks paired with healthy volunteers, including our pre-health students. And just, you know, hundreds of hours have been devoted to these studies, and it's just amazing. Improvisational step patterns. I want to say something. Manuel and I, we practiced plenty for this performance. But we didn't have any steps. So the pieces that we did were completely improvised. And that's yeah, 100%. 100% improvised. But that's part of the art form. It's this wonderful thing. You learn steps, and it's like a toolbox. And you know, you take this tool, and then you take that tool, and you string them all together beautifully. And, you know, when you start in a beginner class, we just say, take step A, take step B, take step C, and put them together. And then as time goes on, you get more steps. But that's the beauty of it. The good thing about it is you can never be wrong. Which I like. Random perturbation. So that goes into the principle of you need to have that thing coming out of nowhere that you have to adjust to. Yeah? So the random perturbation, meaning your partner is dancing with you and you're not sure what they're going to do next, but you have to just be ready. You have to be ready for whatever it is. And that's probably a principle that helps out with the therapy. And then frequent rhythmic variation. Yes, rhythmic variation. Super, super important. To practice all the different rhythms, because I'll tell you a little bit about that, about auditory cues and how important they are as well. Okay, so because of the evidence that I talked about, you know, that the McGill study had shown that the frail older individuals did better after they took tango, I arrived ready to do all kinds of studies. I thought I would be doing these really, really intricate little studies, you know, like, I don't know, seeing how much this muscle twitched or something if you did a really isolated task. But instead, my doctoral advisor suggested that I teach tango to people with Parkinson's. So we went ahead and did that. And what this shows is our main finding, actually. And it was really cool from a physical therapy perspective. This is balance, and it shows that as the scale is higher, that means that you're getting better with balance. And what happened is our tango group and our exercise group, they started out relatively the same, showing that they're at a score that probably was a bit of fall risk. But after their program, their 20 lessons, the tango group improved more and significantly more than did the exercise group. So with this, it was very exciting. The New York Times actually covered it. And so I was really excited for a doctoral student. yeah, it was kind of nice. This was really exciting, so we decided to keep on going with that. And so why might tango be helpful? Okay, so there are a lot of different elements to tango, and I've talked a little bit about, okay, the balance challenge and this and that. But having music could be really, really, really powerful. And it could serve as an auditory cue that has shown to help individuals with Parkinson's disease move faster, keep them going without having some sort of stuttering, and also maintain their cadence, okay? So maintain a regular rhythm as they're walking. And this has been shown both in a laboratory, but also importantly, during functional tasks in the home, which makes it very meaningful towards their ability to perform activities of daily living, which we all need to be able to do. And interestingly, music training may also tap into that neural plasticity idea, because there's been some studies that show that, you know, with music that involves the senses and movement and sound can actually change what's going on in the brain and show there's real plastic changes going on. Did I skip something? So I'm going to show you a quick video, okay, from one of my classes. And this is us working during our class. We actually... because this is an adapted tango, I have changed the format from like what I used to do when I was teaching a general population, and I actually segment out this rhythm section so that they can work on just the ability to work on rhythm, you know, actually stepping to the beat. A lot of people will come and tell me, oh, I can't hear the music, or I don't have rhythm, and they think it's something automatic that they should just know. But that's not true. You have to learn. You have to learn how to listen and know where the beat is. And this is one way that I try to do that. Thank you, Nick. So these are individuals with PD in a study, and you'll see that they're also, this is at Georgia Tech. And they're working very hard to just step right on the beat. And that in and of itself can be very, very challenging. And so we're going to get to do it ourselves. Now, you will not, don't worry, you will not have to come down here or anything, but I would like everyone to stand up and try to just learn. Yes, it's good to stand up every 20 minutes or so. This is all for your health, everyone. Okay, so what you're going to do, we don't have to get a partner. You can if you want, if there's somebody you like to. Go ahead. Typically, we just have anybody, you know, partner up with anybody else. All right, so what we're going to do is practice the tango rhythm, which is T-A-N-G-O. That's the way the American ballroom style is done. In Argentina, we do not do that. But there is a simple T-A-N-G-O. It actually helps if people think about it that way. So what I want you to do is first, let's clap. Ready? Slow, slow, quick, quick, slow. Slow, slow. Slow, slow, quick, quick, and stop. Very good. Now try tapping the rhythm with your foot. Ready? You can do it. It doesn't matter. See, it's great. In adapted tango, you're almost always right, so don't worry about it. So here we go. Ready? Pick a foot, your favorite foot. T, A, quick, quick, slow. Or T, A, N, G, O. Or other five-letter words will work too. N, G, O. Kayak. Y-A-K, or canoe, A-N-O-E. It's a great dual task, actually, exercise. N-G-O and T-A-N-G-O. Okay, now, if you want, grab a partner next to you. Put your arm around them. This is called the best friends position. You two are best friends, right? You and your grandmother? So just wrap your arm around her like this. This is my partner, Manuela, right here. Okay, ready? So what you're gonna do now is you're going to go T, A, just the hips, N, G, O. T, A, N, G, O, and T, A, N, G, O. Okay, very good. And now we're gonna try marching, ready? T, A, N, G, O, and T, A, N, G, O, and T, A, and N, G, O. Very good. All right, let's try it with the music. La musica, maestro! Okay, now we just have to be like in tune. You just have to be like listening to the music and thinking about it. These introductions, they go on for a little while, and we're just really feeling it. Try to commune with our partner, okay? Now try just tapping your foot. T. Slow, slow, quick, quick, slow, and slow, and slow. Slow, let's start over. Slow, quick, quick, slow. Slow, slow, and quick, quick. Now hips. Slow, slow, quick, quick, slow. Slow, slow, quick, quick, slow. And slow, slow, quick, quick, slow. Now put it all together. Spell a five-letter word. A-N-G-O. Now march. Here we go. That's M-A-R-C-H. M. A, R, C, H, M, A, R, C, H, T, A. Back to just tapping. Here we go. Just hips. Wasn't it? Thank you, it was easy, right? So you can dance the tango and dance it, you can dance, you know, coordinate your movement to music and you can do an appropriate rhythm. So if you ever go to tango class or any other kind of dance class, what are you gonna say? T-A-N-G-O. See, it does help. Exactly, so you'll never ever say, I have no rhythm. Nobody in here can say that. Fantastic, everyone. Good job. Okay, this, by the way, is Carlos Di Sarli. A lot of the great music from a lot of the great tango music comes from a while ago, but this is actually in the 1950s, which makes it relatively young, kind of, right? As far as tango music goes. The 50s, eh. Yeah, 1910 is actually the golden period. But I love Rodriguez Peña, so wonderful, wonderful. Okay, so after I looked at tango, I actually looked at something called waltz and foxtrot. We've all heard it. We wanted to see if there were options that we could give people with PD. But if they didn't want to do tango because, it, I don't know, whatever bias they may have had against it or whatever, who knows, maybe it just wasn't their thing. Would other ballroom dances do well? As a matter of fact, they did quite well. Okay, so we actually looked at a group where we had them do waltz and foxtrot, and another group did tango compared to a usual care control group. And we had them do that same balance test where they're supposed to reach forward and grab something or stand on one leg for a while or with one foot right in front of the other. That's what that, this is how we measure balance. Anyway, the waltz and foxtrot group did just as well as our tango group did, which is fantastic. We know we have options. However, we decided to continue with the tango adventure because it's got a lot of, it's got a less of a startup cost. So if you were to do waltz and learn the basic waltz step, that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 weight shifts. Not easy to do. Plus 1, 2, 3, and 4 different directions. That actually takes a lot of coordination and can be pretty tough. So, you know, if you're somebody who's really kind of struggling with some mobility issues. But the tango itself has just the basic step Just the very basic step is the basic. That's it. So because of that low startup cost and also some of the results that we looked at turned out, they did not reach significance. So they weren't what we use in clinical research to say, yes, it definitely changed. But they were very, very promising changes. So we decided to continue with the Tango because it's flexible for therapists if they want to use it. All right, and so we were interested in looking at Tango versus a line dancing Tango class in which they did not have a partner. So they did all the same steps that the partner Tango class did, but without a partner. We did this because we wanted to find out if having a partner, would that be a crutch in a way? Would that attenuate any gains? Well, this is the results from comfortable walking speed, which again we use very, very frequently in studies to see because they have a lot of relationship to mortality and all sorts of measures of cognitive and motor function. And what we found is that having a partner or not having a partner, but having a partner would not attenuate gain. So someone who really needed that partner, like a person with very severe freezing of gait where they really were stuck, definitely need that partner so that they could practice their Tango, that would be fine. That would be fine. And so that's what that study showed. And interestingly, we were able to show that the follow-up period was about 1 month. So after they finished their lessons, they still had those gains. This shows disease severity. So we measure disease severity with something called the Unified Parkinson's Disease Rating Scale. And this is the motor subscale of that particular scale. And that tells us something about disease severity. And what we found is, what I had two groups do this time was a Tango group versus a health and wellness education group. And what we found is that those who participated in Tango had less disease severity after they had finished their 20 lessons or 30 hours of training in comparison to the health and wellness group. So the health and wellness group, they learned all about it. They sat and they listened and they were engaged and they were talking to people and everything, and so they had a lot of social interaction, but it didn't appear to be responsible for the gains that we saw. Actually, performing Tango steps is what led to the disease severity improvements, and that was maintained for 3 months after they had ceased their Tango lessons. And also we were interested in how did these Tango classes, how do they affect cognition, which is super important. As well, how about spatial cognition, which is your ability to get from point A to point B and imagine things in your mind and arrange them spatially. Very, very important for your function. And this is a study that we actually got a significant finding that spatial cognition also improved after they had done Tango, and it was maintained for 3 months after they had ceased their lessons. So overall, over this last 10 years or so, we've been able to show that through several studies that adapted Tango tended to improve balance and improve mobility and quality of life, which is great, and some cognitive results too, which is really, really, really encouraging because we need more therapies that will address cognitive issues. That's actually very huge. But importantly, the participants enjoyed the classes, and they were extremely compliant. We had something like 85% compliance, meaning they kept on coming to the lessons and they did what they were supposed to do, as opposed to other therapies that have like 45 to 60% is much more common. Okay, so that's actually really, really cool, and they seem to enjoy it overall. Since 2006, 168 people with Parkinson's and about 57 older adults have participated and completed the program. So that does include the spouses and friends and loved ones and caregivers who also participated in the lessons as well. So that's encouraging. So why partner dance? Well, I think if you've ever danced with a partner, you might notice that if you ever have like a lightest of touch contact, that can actually enhance your balance. So you just think about that. That's something else to think about, you know, as you're going around. Just put your hand out just a little bit and see if it really enhances your balance. It does. It's pretty amazing that way. So amazing how our nervous system arranges and gathers. The more information that your nervous system can gather in a way, the better your balance will be. Also, a partner is probably serving as an external help, as a cue that can help people maintain their cadence, help them maintain normal stride lengths, and in general, maybe enhance their sense of where their body parts are in space and where they are in space. And I'm very interested in studying, actually. Now my studies are kind of going more in that direction. I want to look at the specific roles of leader versus follower, because I think there's a cognitive overlay that's very different between the two roles. There are a lot of similarities, but there's also these key differences that I think should be studied, because I think we can learn about them and find out what neural pathways are underlying what you're doing, if you're leading movement or if you're following movement. And that can help us with motor therapy. So the follower has to have this sort of online motor program flexibility, ability to just go into whatever the leader wants them to do. You know, just step and wait, try to figure it out. That was me trying to figure out what Manuel wanted me to do earlier. And that was quite a ride. I enjoyed it. You have to be able to detect those cues. You have to figure out what it is. You have to pay attention to aesthetics. How do my legs look? You know, that kind of thing. Balance reaction. You have to be ready whenever they come towards you. And then you have to have this sort of leader-centric perspective. So you just really focus on the leader and the cues, and that's what's going on. It's that sort of mindset that's going on. Whereas the leader has to plan all sorts of things. They have to plan the movement program. They have to determine direction, timing. They have to determine where they're going, the path. How far will you step? It's very, very complex what the leader has to think about, and yet it all comes out in one. And they have to have a world-centric perspective, meaning they have to know where they're going, they have to pay attention to the other couples, they have to also pay attention to their partner, and they have to be thinking about the next step. So there's a lot going on, and there's big differences between what a leader is thinking about and a follower. Of course, everyone's working on moving and standing, balance control, whole body coordination, heightened spatial and tactile awareness, which is the stuff that we kind of covered in the first 10 years of the studies. But now I'm going to start looking at studies where I have people do just the leader role and just the follower role, so we can tease out these differences and find out how they affect neural pathways or brain pathways and connections. So again, followers generally responding to external cues. Leader is planning and selecting movement, doing that internal guidance stuff that the basal ganglia is very responsible for. Okay, and of course you have this assistive partner. I just want to talk a little bit about who that person is. That person should be able to detect the level of postural instability in an individual who has postural instability. They have to plan the sort of optimal motor program that's based on the principles of partnered improvised dance. And they have to monitor that individual continually for loss of balance and prevent falls. So I've had a range of individuals in the studies, and some of them are like fully ambulatory, and you would hardly know that they have any sort of Parkinson's disease. Others have been in walkers, or have used walkers, or have been in wheelchairs, or have arrived in class in wheelchairs. But they get up, and they dance with their partner. And those folks, I can tell that it really, really means a lot to them. And it's really exciting that they're able to participate so meaningfully in these classes. Okay, and I don't know, but maybe, okay. So a lot of times people are like, okay, so how well did they do the steps in the classes? And so that's not so important. It's the act of practicing, attempting the movement, and just trying and going through the process of learning. I think that's the most important thing, and that's what we try to emphasize in the therapy more than anything else. And so, yeah, the idea that, for all I know, the fact that they have the participants in the study have switched from leader to follower in the class might have had a lot to do with the benefits. That is a cognitive exercise that's very challenging and may improve. So maybe it's being exposed to new movement and then attempting to perform and then immediately seeing and trying the flip version of the movement is very, very therapeutic. But we won't be able to know that unless we look at just following and just leading. So I want to just show you another video from my classes. Go ahead. And this shows people very focused on their partner, the idea that they're watching each other and trying to pick up cues. Now this couple is very good. They're really focusing on each other and able to dance quite nicely together. Thank you, John. He's sitting right here. Nice work. Okay, so we're gonna do another partnering exercise. This time you will need a partner, but I want you to get the idea. So go ahead and stand up. It's good for you to stand up. All right, turn and face a partner. Okay, so what I want you to do, come on down. All right, so I want you to hold each other's elbows. Okay, so just face me. I have a mic. Pretend like I have an arm there. All right, so what I want you to do is first try to push their elbows behind their back a little bit. Oh, well, they should resist. Manuel and John, y'all come down so everybody can see. Okay, if you need any extra visual cues, Manuel and John will show you. All right, so you're gonna, this is Victoria. Okay, so Victoria, try this with me. Don't let me push your elbows behind your back. Don't let me push them. So push your elbows forward. There you go. Very good. Very good. Okay, now try to push your elbows. Try to push the forearms together. But don't let me do it. Very good. Now try to push them apart. Very good. Try it straight down. Okay, excellent. Now switch roles. Victoria, try to push my elbows behind my back. Victoria, try to push my arms together. Try to push them apart. Very good. In all the different directions. Okay. So when you're dancing together, you have to sort of maintain that. That's called the frame, and it's super important. So now what I want you to do is one person decide that they're going to be the leader, and one person decide between the two of you who's going to be leader and who's going to be follower. Okay, Victoria, do you want to be leader or follower? You want to follow? Okay, no problem. All right. So what I want you to do, oh, this is good. This is good. Because sometimes we have people with stroke and they have their arm. So, yeah, okay. So you just hold on to my arm like there. Okay, very good. So what you're going to do now, you're going to maintain this frame. Very, very important. We do not need spaghetti noodle arms. Oh, here we go. Okay. All right. So I want you leaders to just shift your weight like we did earlier. Oh, maybe that T-A-N-G-O rhythm. Maybe not. She needs a partner right there. Yeah. There you go. Okay, so what I want you to try is this. Now try this, guys. Followers, close your eyes. Trust. Yay! All right. Okay, so what I want you to do, followers, close your eyes. And now, leaders, be a little tricky. I want you to shift your weight, be clear, but don't be too predictable. And followers, try to shift your weight when the leaders are shifting their weight. And you can do again, you can do the T-A-N-G row rhythm, or you can do a waltz. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Or you can just hang out for a while in tango. It's perfectly allowed. All right, let's try that to the music, okay? Yes. La musica, por favor, maestro. This is the dramatic music of Osvaldo Pugliese, and he has all sorts of creative things. So just let it out, guys. Keep those eyes closed. Eyes closed. Switch roles. You're gonna lead me, Victoria. Okay, I'm gonna be very good, I promise. Oh, wow. Victoria, that's tricky. My goodness. Okay, muy bien, very good, everyone. Thank you so much, Victoria, wonderful. Okay, so did anyone, I'm just curious, did anyone try the tango rhythm to this song? A little more difficult, right, than the earlier song? Maybe a little bit more difficult? Un poco? No, you found it easy enough? The T-A-N-G-O? To la Nueve de Julio? Okay, well, good, 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 good. That Nueve de Julio is a little bit more, they got to go off meter, I guess, a little bit. Okay, well, that's good. I hope you, did you get the idea of what it's like to lead and follow and everything? Good, very good, okay. Mechanisms. Does this excite anyone? Oh, brains? Yeah. All right, I'll talk to you then. Okay, so this is, these are brains that were taken with a functional magnetic resonance imaging, fMRI, when you're doing a task in the brain scanner. Okay, so I just want to talk really quickly about this last bit, you know, because it talks about the future of the field and other sorts of things. We have to look at the brain and what it's doing when it's going through these therapies. And there's two ideas of what might be happening. It's either remediation, as in the part that's not functioning well in PD is actually getting better. Is that what is happening in Tango? We don't know, but it could be. Or is there something sort of like compensating going, a compensation mechanism, where the external cues that I've been talking about are allowing the brain, it doesn't access the brain parts that are affected by PD, but other parts that are relatively intact, like the cerebellum, for example. We don't know, so we have to do these studies. So I want to connect it to leading and following. So maybe remediation is happening. And because leading involves planning and selecting movements, maybe dancing the lead role is helping the brain areas that are most affected by Parkinson's disease, and then it benefits movement. Conversely, maybe it's because following involves responding to external cues, maybe dancing the following role will use other brain areas that are not affected by PD and benefit the movement. We don't know, we have to figure it out. We don't know the answers yet. I just want to show you one more video from my class where I'm leading a participant who, first of all, she doesn't quite get the movement, but then she does, and it's all improvised. All improvised, and she's just paying attention. I haven't told her anything that we're gonna do. Little hiccup there.
Oh, almost there. Trust my lead, though. I'll say it. T-A-N-G-O. Okay? Da, dee, da, dee, da, ah, just watch me. Dee, da, da. Just watch, watch.
And she gets it perfectly because she really focuses and she uses her ability to detect the cues. Very good. And hopefully after my years of learning how to guide people, I was also able to give her cues that were worthy of being followed. Hopefully. Okay, so future research. Insufficient information exists about human-to-human interactions in dance and other movement forms, so we need to learn more about them. And how humans communicate sophisticated motor intentions through pressure and through touch and other means. We need to know about that. We need to know how they do this. And I think that knowledge about brain changes after they've gone through a program of adapted tango or other forms. I mean, it could be other forms. Adapted tango is my thing, but it could be others. I think this will help develop better rehabilitation training strategies for those with PD as well as older adults. So the future research, I have a series of fMRI studies planned where they're doing an internally generated task and an externally generated task, and we're seeing what areas are activated during those tasks. Now, it's going to take a long time to really, you know, analyze the data properly to get real answers, but it's very, very exciting, and that's going on right now at the Atlanta VA and also at Emory School of Medicine. Argentine tango, by the way, is danced throughout the entire world. It's really, really exciting. It's danced by absolutely fanatical dancers, and we actually have a lot of tango dancing going on right here in Atlanta, right, Manuel? Yes, and feel free, you know, just Google Tango Atlanta, and you'll find out, you know, where you can go tango dancing tomorrow night if you'd like. Tonight. Do it. Go take a class. Manuel and his wife teach, and they're fantastic, Manuel and Rhonda. Adapted tango is actually gaining popularity around the world, too, slowly, but I am contacted by many people who want to do things very, very similar in other parts of the United States and other parts of the world, Australia and England, and just to name a few. And excitingly, the international scientific and clinical communities have shown great interest. Some people may be a little more skeptical, but in general, they're very excited about it. I think we need these, you know, beautiful art forms. We need to add art to medicine. I think that will make it a lot more palatable, and I think we'll make great headway that way. And so dance has always had multifaceted roles in society, and I think Selma Jean Cohen certainly knew that. And this body of work has examined dance for its powers to heal, its powers to form connections between individuals of diverse backgrounds and needs. And that's really, really true, because we have folks who are, you know, adult children, 18 years old, all the way up to 90-year-olds, 95-year-old is the oldest person who completed a program of adapted tango dancing, by the way. And that, you know, interaction is just fantastic to watch, intercommunication and intergenerational approaches. So dance has the ability to penetrate one of the most challenging of human conditions, the degeneration of the ability to move. But through dance, they may learn to move again, and I think we can too. So there you go. That's it. That's all, folks. Okay, great. I do have one more thing I want to show you. We have a participant, a very talented participant from some of the tango's Adapted Tango program. This is Mr. John Dixon. You may have seen him in the video. And he and I are going to show you a quick piece of some of the Adapted Tango syllabus. We have 24 individual lessons that are new and complete, each one. And we won't be able to get through all 24 lessons, but we'll show you a lot of what we do. Okay? So please enjoy, and here we go. And then I'll take Q&A, and maybe you'll have some questions for John as well. Thank you. Do I have time for one or two questions, or? Okay, go ahead, okay. And for John, perhaps, too, as well. Anybody? Yes.
When's the next lesson?
When's the next lesson? As a matter of fact, we take volunteers of all kinds, and if you ever wanted to come, we are teaching classes Monday through Thursday at 12:30 to 2 at the Atlanta VA in the Movement Science Laboratory.
Do you do distance learning?
Oh! Well, I have to work on the telemedicine version, but there are issues with that, but we're working on it. What, telemedicine?
No, it might not be such a bad idea.
No, we'll see. Maybe, yeah, we have to go that route.
Are those who work with veterans?
Yes, definitely we work with veterans. We try to encourage as many veterans to participate as possible.
And what have you learned from that? What did they learn from?
Oh, well, they participate. You know, a lot of folks over the years are vets, either from World War II or Korea, or now it's more and more Vietnam. And we haven't looked at them specifically. I haven't actually taken out just the vet population. But they've been wonderful participants. Yes, Lee?
So do you work with stroke victims or others?
Yeah, so I have plans to do that, actually. One of my mentors is Dr. Stephen Wolf, who's very renowned stroke researcher, and we have plans to do that. And I actually have a case study in disability rehabilitation where an individual with chronic stroke, he was a 9-year stroke survivor, participated and was able to participate meaningfully, and he experienced several gains in mobility and cognition too, I think. Yes?
Hi, I'm Emily, this is my colleague Latika. We work with undergraduates.
So oh, great.
Imagining how embarrassed they might be to dance and to make mistakes. How do you deal with shame or embarrassment in the class?
How do I deal with that? I'm going to answer the question, and then I would love John to give his
what
point of view
question?
About that. Oh, yeah. So she was wondering, she works with a lot of undergraduates, and she thinks that they might feel like they'd be have shame or embarrassment because they messed up the steps. Well, that's probably a thing, but I don't know. It hasn't been a huge issue because, like I said, it's adapted tango, so you're always right. And they're in a context of, they're seeing individuals who are struggling with much more difficult issues than any of them have, and they're coming to help. So I think they, in general, and we teach the classes in such a way that all of you were able to get this, right? We teach it at a level that people feel pretty comfortable handling, and so that I think that we create an environment where everybody is pretty accepted and wanted to be there, and we are so grateful for any volunteers that we have that we're able to do that. I mean, I could talk about this for a long time. I would love for you to come to the class and you can see what we do. And John, do you have anything to add about that?
I'd like to say that, well, one thing, this is done in the context of a scientific study, so you're not coming there to be social necessarily, but it ends up that way. And also, there's about 15 minutes of warm-up.
Yeah, we do about 20-minute warm-up.
Yeah, and so that helps to kind of break the ice, too, because then we do movement generally in a circle, but also we move around, and sometimes you saw as we started, we were just like y'all doing in the audience.
Mm-hmm, very simply.
It's very simple movements.
So everyone feels comfortable right from the very beginning.
And I've done a lot of other kind of dancing, so I'm kind of used to it, but I see that really just simple movements together breaks the ice.
Cool.
Is
there Thank
question?
You.
One more question?
We have one more question there.
Do you use anthropology in it at all in terms of communication?
Oh, my goodness. I don't know enough about anthropology to do that, but I would love to chat with you about, do you have an idea in particular?
Catherine Dunham visited 52 countries.
Yeah.
She helped to socialize that with the United States.
Mm-hmm.
And I think because you've taken this to the cognitive and the other levels for human-to-human interaction, you could probably revisit many things.
Oh, absolutely. That's a fantastic idea. Would love to hear more about what your thoughts are on that. Thank you.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much, John. Thank you so much. And, thank you very much.